My dad wanted me to play the blues. My mom didn't. My dad did.
What he would tell me, Jackie, make them love you. Just make them love you.
I know that, you know, you walk into a room and you see that there's a Hammond organ player. It's like, oh, you know, this is going to be something a little different, you know.
So I don't really think about anything else once I'm on stage apart from what sounds are surrounding me. And I think that if I can get lost in the music, then I always consider it's a good gig. So I know I am a bit, maybe a bit too introvert on stage.
God bless us all. You gotta be nuts to play this instrument.
Part of the mystique of playing the Hammond is the Hammond itself. You know, the size, the pedals, and all that.
Dating rings was a big thing with the Hammond, and of course, church.
If you want to see people swing, give them some Hammond bass.
They were never able to break through to the mass of jazz lovers.
Oh, no. Oh, God. And then I got to, ooh, shit. My God. And I said, well, I got to get one.
Lawrence Hammond, by some accounts, was tone deaf. He really wasn't a musician. He had no idea. He was an inventor. He had a clock company. And a genius, to be sure. But he invented things like card shufflers and 3D glasses. And his clock really was the basis for this electromechanical device he called the Hammond organ.
There are wheels with 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, and multiples of, they're not really teeth, they're ridges on the end of the tone wheel in the shape of a sine wave. And as they rotate, they pass by a magnetized rod with a coil wound on it. And as the steel tone wheel approaches and falls back from the magnetized rod, it develops a electrical current. It's actually an alternator, just like in your car, only on a much smaller scale, and there's 91 of them.
I do understand the basics, but if anything serious goes wrong, I have to take it to an engineer. It's really hard to find a good engineer these days. Not vintage equipment generally, but Hammond's is such a specific thing. It's quite a feat of engineering, really.
Though Lawrence Hammond wanted this to go into the church to try to reproduce the big pipe organ and compete with the pipe organ, it was the radio stations and the theaters and the show business industry that kind of embraced this Hammond organ, much to his chagrin. Thomas Fats Waller played the Hammond organ. He was one of the first to buy one in the mid-30s, had one installed in his apartment, and of course his famous Jitterbug Waltz was recorded on a Hammond organ in 1941. That was the Fats Waller style that you heard up until the war. There were other great stars on the Hammond organ, more pop music. Jesse Crawford, Ethel Smith.
Now let's really get hot.
Yeah.
Let's go below the border for some South American jive.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, kiddies. I mean, very well, ladies. But everyone will have to help.
Okay, Mitty, we're with you.
What drove me to the organ was listening to Wild Bill Davis. He played basically chords, mostly little single note solos, a little bit, not much, mostly chords, and it's, his approach to it was a little different.
Bill Davis, during World War II, saw the Hammond organ as a replacement for the big band. He could get this big orchestral sound, and instead of hiring 18, 19 people, just hire three of us and we've got that big sound for you.
When I heard that April in Paris, Bill Davis, that was it. It drove me out. No, I'm gonna get me one now. The drums and guitar accompanied him.
There's a few standard registrations that people tend to use. The Jimmy Smith sound. That kind of a thing. If we pull out the fourth drawbar, and I need to change a little bit of the decay over here, it's more of the Charles Erland sound. Let's see here. That kind of a thing. And you know, one thing that's kind of neat too is that is talking back between these keyboards.
You can have the registration of a Jimmy Smith, inclusive of percussion on, but it's the way that you as the individual play it that makes it sound a different way.
One night the organist didn't show up, and I asked Pastor, could I go play the organ from the piano? He said, well, can you play it? I said, I think so. And I got on it, and I absolutely could not coordinate pedal work with hand work from the piano.
I felt like, hey, I could play that because it's like a piano in a sense, you know? So this guy called me up to play, or was rehearsing or something. Anyway, they called me up to, you know, to do the organ. I didn't even know how to turn it on.
So we set it up, a lot of us organ players set up. Some people like four out. I know Linda likes to play like Charles Erland. He liked these four out. Don Patterson, he liked his percussion on slow decay. Jimmy Smith had the fast decay. Don Patterson liked the slow. Just a little different. Just enough. It decays just a little longer on the slow decay. And if I turn that off, you'd hear it. You know how long it takes to decay? So that's being blended in with the three drawbars. That's slow. That's fast.
And it took a minute to establish how I wanted to approach it. And in 56, I heard Jimmy Smith for the first time. The incredible Jimmy Smith, that first went at the champ and put that on. Good grief! So I bought one. He put the organ on the map.
From 1955, 56 on, everybody that sits down at the Hammond organ has a little Jimmy Smith in them.
Jazz Scene USA. Miles Davis, who is not usually moved to superlatives, is said to have described Jimmy Smith as the eighth wonder of the world. Certainly none can dispute that Jimmy is the first wonder of the world of jazz organ.
He took the organ combo into a whole new direction. When he first came out, I mean, everybody showed up to hear him in these little organ rooms. I guess it would be comparable today, somebody coming out with a, not necessarily a new instrument, but a whole new sound on that instrument.
He was a piano player before he went to organ. I heard some things that he did on the piano. Okay, also ran. But when he started and switched over to the organ, it was almost an awakening, really.
He came up with a gritty, bluesy sound, a soloing sound on the Hammond organ that heretofore was unheard of, that no one had thought about.
Jimmy was burning up in popularity. This guy came here, and man, I tell you, it was Excedrin headache number 92. I can't believe anybody's playing like that.
At the Majestic Hotel, the Rose Room, if I'm not mistaken, and I'm going, this is in 1958. So that's how long ago it was, man. And like I said, that organ came on with Jimmy, and I mean, it just, people ain't never recovered from that, man. It was a whole new way of life, musically speaking.
Soulful, gritty, greasy organist on the planet. And obviously, if people followed Wild Bill Davis, they surely were going to follow Jimmy Smith. And that's where you get this parade of people now chasing Jimmy Smith.
So I ordered chicken, you know, and a beer, and Jimmy went up to the bandstand. They started their set. First thing he played was a preacher, you know, and they cranked that thing up, you know. And I was just about to take a bite out of the chicken wing, you know, and it went up. I was so thrilled with the music. It hit the ceiling, and it came back down and landed in my lap.
When I was 12 years old, I'd been playing the accordion for 4 years. I was playing tunes like Malagueña and Granada and O Solo Mio and, you know, all the Italian mazurkas and polkas and everything, and I loved all that stuff. I put this Jimmy Smith's Greatest Hits record.
It's been a while.
And the first tune I put on was The Sermon. Do 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 do. The moment I put that on, it was like instantly I was taken by the music. I knew that I was going to be an organ player. I then started grabbing the box and kept trying to play what I was hearing on the record. And in the bottom of that record, it had an address. So I started recording cassettes of me playing Jimmy Smith on the Cordovox and sending them to that address. Well, on my 16th birthday, coincidence, of course, maybe not, My dad woke me up and said, you gotta come over here. I went to his bedroom, you know, he was in bed too, it was late at night. And I picked up the phone and it was this growling voice. Anthony, he called me Anthony because everybody knew me as Anthony then. He said, Jimmy Smith. I can't even describe how I felt right at that moment. I was freaking out, it's Jimmy Smith. He said, don't worry about playing all them notes. You gotta learn how to play the right chords.
I didn't know what it was then, but it was frightening. You hear this cat play, man. I said, boy, this cat is in here playing this organ like somebody I never in my life heard before. And swinging, oh man, I'm talking about, oh. That was a turning point, man, in a whole lot of people's lives.
First, to get in, you have to set the organ up on the end and put it on a, one of them little flat dolly things.
You did a right face, and you went and you pulled the door open, and you went into a vestibule.
And then grip it around the doors like that. All right, you just getting started.
You go in the club, and there was a bar. The bar is about, it's pretty high.
You gotta lift that organ up on top of the bar, then get up on the bar and lift it on that bandstand.
It took four guys, at least four guys.
Like this. And then two of them guys up on the top dragging it to get it up. It was a real nightmare.
The church was the first place that Africans were allowed to express themselves. And that gives them the one place that they can come and express themselves without interference from the outside. It's the same with, they want the music expressive, they want to be expressive in the pulpit. That's why we have so many pulpitarians are civic leaders. And so it comes down to a sense of dynamics and a sense of leadership. So it is carried on, And I think the Hammond organ, in its emergence in the 30s, really spoke to the gospel church. It really spoke to it. And the funny thing is now we have gotten into an electronic age where now synthesizers has become the thing. But I'm here to say that if you do not have a Hammond in your church, you are not churching. You know what I mean? There's some ministers that always want a music backdrop. Some don't want any backdrop. But a music backdrop is while a minister is talking. It's something that doesn't, you don't want to do things like, you know, do things that grab people and they start paying attention to you. But so you just stay with some, you know. And then if he said, now, you know, say, we want to do better. You follow him up a little bit with the music. He said, you know, say, how many is there anybody in the house that believes we can do better? And they say, yeah. And then you move into some diminished chord, you know, and say, somebody say amen. You know? The organ that I had over at church in Richmond, we bought the organ from a devil worshiping rock group. Had cigarette burns on it. It didn't make any difference where it came. Once we got in the church, it was sanctified. Because it was about the person who was playing it more than it was about the instrument itself, you know. And if the person who was playing it, if their spirit was right, then we had a good service. And that's what mattered. If a drug dealer is driving the limousine tonight and his career ends, and tomorrow you might see a preacher driving the same car. I don't think they even think twice about it, you know. So certainly not the instrument, certainly not.
people playing blues on an organ already are mixing a metaphor, right? Where the organ belongs to the church, but the blues belongs to the devil.
What Jimmy Smith did and the followers in the late 50s and early 60s, they were the ones that took the organ out of the church and created a whole new approach to what spiritual music is. All of this music is divine, and that means you have to say that, you know, the nasty, freaky partying you're doing on Friday, well, that's a blessing. And that means you have to break from these Western conceptions of what is sacred and what is secular. It was part of Black folks reclaiming their own identity to say, you know, we don't necessarily live in this binary system, particularly when we've been placed in the bottom part of the binary for so long.
In the gospel church, where they've gotten used to gospel organ, anything goes. I mean, we're not sitting down trying to totally rock down, you know, we're not sitting down and just trying to just like swing with it, you know. I don't just swing like that. Even though in some songs you do give you that freedom, I don't, you know, I stay pretty much to a church sound.
So many people are agonizing over whether something is truly jazz, right? I mean, is Ray Charles truly jazz? Is Louis Jordan truly jazz? You know, that's because the whole project of defining jazz is part and parcel of a project of defining high art.
I've always referred to the organ as an instrument that has been neglected and not abused, but you know, treated like the red-headed stepsister, if you will, never been given the due. And consequently, the wonderful players who have played it through the years have never been given their due.
You know, what are the classic ones? What kind of piano is that? Or what kind of keyboard are you playing? I hate that one, keyboard. It's just like, you have no idea what I've gone through. And you're calling it a keyboard? Yeah, you rubbernecker.
When you look at that famous picture in Harlem of 1958, Count Basie's there, but there's no jazz organists represented. Up until last year, when you go to the International Association of Jazz Educators Conference, and you look at the form, there's no checklist for an organist. I mean, it's always been something in the miscellaneous category.
There was a period of time where the soul jazz was king. In turn, all of that groove stuff, all of the organ stuff, based around the organ stuff, were being played on a national basis. Virtually every release that I had for a period of a couple of years, it was either black talk, or soul jazz, or, you know, it had to have soul or something like that in it. During that period of time, with all of that, and the emergence of the black market as an influence, and you look to appeal to that. It wasn't contrived. It was not contrived sitting in Bergenfield, but it more or less reflected what was happening in the street.
Most of it was the producer trying to come up with a catchy phrase or title that would catch the buying public's attention.
How'd you feel about that?
I didn't care. I mean, I had no control over it. If I had wanted to change to something else, who was I? I was just the artist.
People still sort of, you know, beat their feet and snapped their finger and got off on this record that, you know, thrilled them and got them excited, and it's still good improvisational jazz.
If we were to say that organ music were rhythm and blues, it's just a form of rhythm and blues. It's rhythm and blues because you can dance to it. It's rhythm and blues because it's got the same kind of chord structure. It's rhythm and blues. It's just rhythm and blues, right? So then what do you do with it? Do you then say, okay, well, it's not worth dealing with? You know, if it were jazz, that'd be a different matter. No. So already there's a judgment here that can be couched in, you know, quasi-objective terms. Is it more complex? Is it more refined? Is it more serious? Is it more uplifting, elevating, progressive? What is the cultural work that this music does? What is the aesthetic work that this music does?
That was one of the outlets that we could actually rely on, that we could do and make a decent living at it. And the only way we could express ourselves in our view of what we was living up under, that slavery mentality, was through the music.
So that was a conscious decision you made to do the funk, pop?
Absolutely. Yes.
Did
absolutely.
You take any static for that?
Some. Well, I got some from Richard Groove Holmes, my hero, you know? Oh man, you don't want to be playing that stuff. But 2 years later, he was playing that stuff.
Because I wanted to relate to the general public. I want them to enjoy what I'm recording. Not have to be loaded or wearing 5-inch thick beards and shit and strange hats and all that other shit in order to enjoy my music. That's not what I want. Sometimes there would be a person that I had met at some point in my life or an experience. I would entitle a song regarding that. There was a song called The Barbecue Man that was written because of a black guy here in Houston, and he cooked the best barbecue I had ever eaten, okay?
That was a good way of showing the knowledge about us black people. Like I said, man, soul food, shitlin' con carne. That was a very important part of it. So, but like I said, the music describes the people. If you listen to it, you can hear it. And it wasn't all bad, because there come a time when we have to smile too. You know what I'm saying? And we have to love too. So this music is a description of a way of life.
I was getting it from the jukebox, you know? When the band finished playing, I don't care who it was, man. Then I started hearing Aretha, you know, and Marvin. And it was clear, man. It was clear what was going on. It was clear where the music was going. It was gonna go there.
Look at this shaky forms that we're seeing around us. I could write forever trying to explain this. You see what I'm saying? The ducks, the cars, the beautiful lake, the building, the beautiful sky. Hey, just living life. The buses, I mean, hey, I can sit here and write songs forever and never come to an end. That's what this music is about. Shapes and forms.
Every person, regardless of the race or the religion, goes through at some point negativity. The negativity that I've gone through is not expressed in my performance. No way. I'm not even thinking about that. You know? You think negative, then your performance is negative. I saw people negating black musicians and black performers, negating their intelligence, their manhood, their womanhood, talking to them like they were kids, because they were in some modicum of control or management or power to make things happen. You know, you don't have to talk down to me. You don't have to negate my intelligence. You don't know me.
Yeah, it was a situation where you had to mind your P's and Q's.
I remember when you go to a place just to get water, they wouldn't give you water, or they would break the glass. It was very difficult.
We never played below the Mason-Dixon line, you know. It's always up north, you know. I don't know what we would have gotten into down south, you know. But I heard some stories from Lou Donaldson and Jimmy Smith, you know, that it was bad, you know. Treated like second-class citizens, you know.
Because when they call me, they say, we want you to come play, but you can't bring no friends because we don't allow colored. does that. So I tell you, well, I don't think I want the job. But back in those days, they didn't say black like they say now. They say colored. Yeah. That's behind us, thank goodness.
Now is probably the best time in the last 20 years to be playing the organ, certainly since I've been playing, which is, you know, the last 12 years. It's really reached a new level, which is great. A lot of younger guys are getting into it now. People always ring me up because I'm known for playing, you know, just the organ. I don't play keyboards, I just play organ. So people are always ringing me up and saying, I've seen this Hammond, do you think I should buy it? And, you know, I'm happy to help them because that's how I got into it, somebody helped me.
How important is the concept of legacy to you?
Personally, and maybe I have done something that I didn't realize how important it was, for people to continue to ask, purchase if possible, and listen to my music. I was shocked. I guess I was far in advance of my time.
I feel like for me to develop as an organ player, I need to pay homage to these people that have, you know, come before me.
Wherever I could play the organ, I'd play it, and it was in the black establishments that was appreciated, really, you know. I played a few white places back then, you know, and I get up there and we play our hearts out and people look at us like we're crazy, you know, like no response at all, you know, and say, well, you know, like, oh, get rid of these guys, they're horrible, you know. But you go into another place, a black joint, you know, and oh, wow.
White players, that's good, especially for the organ. Because the organ in the first place is a stepchild as far as jazz is concerned. But, and you had just about only the black players playing the organ, which people enjoyed. But you weren't getting that wide audience. Slowly we were beginning to get it. It takes the music in another direction. It's in another sort of appreciative mode and for that kind of music, I would say. So, but it's not about being competitive, unless there's money. Then it becomes competitive, you know.
See, the music is a universal language. And this is one way that we can all communicate without having to talk. And it's a spiritual meeting, so. And it, I think it gets to a certain level where it ain't even about no color.
You know, as far as the general public, at one time, man, if you couldn't swing, you know, man, you couldn't play, you know, especially with a black audience, you know. And today, it's different, you know. Like in the last 20 years, most of my artists have been primarily white, you know. And so as long as you get up there and you play good, you know, and something they can relate to, you're okay. But as far as them feeling your music, nah, for the most part. You go into a restaurant, you play, and they carry on a conversation while you're playing, you know.
Because now, a lot of the groups ain't got organs. combination of things, cost or whatever, they use multi keyboards. They'll have two keyboards. You know, but, I don't want to play that. If I can't take my organ to the gig, I don't want the gig. That's it.
Say after 30 years I'm still getting this abundance of play, why am I not recording on a label? Look at that, man. That's crazy. Can you believe that? You would not believe it until you saw it.
You got play in Kazakhstan.
Look at that, man. My God, what are they playing there? First gravy?
Future fans.
Okay.
All right, I'm waving at you.
Thank you.